Well, good evening, everybody. It's wonderful to have you along again this evening. I hope that you're all doing well. In regards to our family, we feel very blessed at the moment being able to spend this time together. We have a lot to be grateful for. We do have some health issues still, and we appreciate you praying into that with us. But otherwise, we are doing well. We're very blessed to be able to take delivery of a large parcel of food this week from someone in the church. And this particular family really, really blessed us. They bought stuff for us that we never or very rarely are able to buy for ourselves. And it was a major blessing. I want to thank them publicly right now. You know who you are. And we're very grateful to the Lord and to you for that generosity. In regards to this hair issue that I'm facing at the moment, I want you to know that I'm identifying firmly with Samson. And while I keep my head down and carry on that treadmill grinding grain, my hair is slowly beginning to grow. So my authority and my anointing will return over the next couple of weeks, we fully expect. The only thing is then is that when it's fully grown, I'm just deciding whether or not, like Samson, I'm going to bring the house down or not. And when I think about that, I don't really know, because I could prove a point and really get my kids, you know, in subjection after tricking me into this haircut, but at the same time, I would wreck my own house. So some advice on that from any of you would be welcome. We're going to have some time in worship in just a moment, and then we're going to go into part three of Jeff Milan's series in Ephesians right now, which, of course, he's originally recorded for Union Church back in Ute, where he is the pastor. Very grateful for his input during this time, and he sends his love and greetings to you along with Corin as they are locked down here in the UK. After that, we're going to have some time of prayer and reflection. And when we do that, could I please ask you especially just to uphold David Brett at the moment, who is certainly experiencing some pretty bad symptoms of COVID. It's confirmed that he has the virus right now, and he is home alone, and we're keeping a very close eye on him with our InTouch team. But please do uphold him in prayer for God's protection, for the wisdom of any medical professionals around him and so on, and that he would get the correct treatment. Other than that, friends, hope you enjoy the service tonight. Just relax in God's presence, enjoy his voice speaking to you. And as your heart worships, I know that his presence will be right where you are. God bless you, everybody. Have a great rest of the week.
How Ephesians 2, verse 1 to 9. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much, that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. For He raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of His grace and kindness towards us, as shown in all He has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. God saved you by His grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it.
Good morning. The Bible says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." And I trust that through these challenging times for many, we will take every opportunity to bring praise and honor and glory to our God and Savior. We're continuing today the third part of our series on the book of Ephesians, and we're in chapter 2 today. I read the story this week of three men who had died in a car crash, and they went to heaven for orientation. And they were all asked the same question. When you are in your casket and people come around you and look at you, what would you like to hear them saying? The first man said, "I'd love to hear them say he was an exceptional doctor and a wonderful family man." The second man quickly said, "I want to hear them say I was a great husband and father and an amazing school teacher." The third man pondered for a while and he said, "I want to hear them saying, I can see he's breathing, he's moving." Well, some people will do anything to grab onto life. As a matter of fact, it's a natural instinct. We want to stay alive. And there are many reasons for that. People love this world and what this world offers. Naturally, people are afraid of dying. They're not sure what's going to happen, how it's going to happen. They're not sure if there is life beyond the grave. Some may be fearful of hell. But you know, the sad truth is that many people are already dead and they don't know it. They're dead spiritually. They're dead to God. They're dead to Jesus Christ. Sin has killed them and made them dead to the things of God. And we don't realize how devastating sin is in the lives of everyone. A football coach once wanted to show his players just how dangerous drugs are. And so he arranged for one of his friends to burst into a team meeting and throw on the table a 5-foot cobra during that meeting. Well, he did that, and these brave young men screamed and went flying when they saw the cobra. And then the coach said to them, "When drugs come into the room, you're probably not as sharp as you were with that cobra. But I want to tell you, drugs kill as much as that cobra kills. If you play with either, you're going to die." You see, sin comes in all its forms, but it's destroying our world. It's killed people. It's made people spiritually dead, dead to God, dead in Christ. Many people feel they can handle sin. They can control sin. You know, I know how to deal with it. I'm not going to let it take a hold of me. It reminds me of a zookeeper who was mentoring some people who were looking after raccoons, and they were becoming pets for these people. And at one stage, he warned them. He said, "Look, at 24 months, there's a glandular change that takes place in raccoons. And you have to be very careful because at that point of time, they often go and attack their owners. And a 15-kilogram raccoon can attack as badly as a 50-kilogram dog in a fight. One lady listened politely. She smiled and then she answered, "Look, it will be different for me. Mine would never, ever hurt me. He just wouldn't." 3 months later, she underwent plastic surgery for facial lacerations sustained when her raccoon attacked her for no reasons whatsoever. You know, sin can come dressed in adorable disguises, and we play with it. So it's going to be different for me. It won't take a hold of me. But I want to tell you, the results are predictable. Sin kills. Sin may appear harmless and pleasurable, but eventually it will turn on you and it will scar you. It will kill you. Sin kills the life out of people. It takes over, it takes control, and then it kills. But you know, there are wonderful, wonderful words for us that there is an escape, and that is through Jesus Christ, our Lord. He alone gives victory over sin. You all know Romans 6:23. It says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord." And in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 10, Paul gives a path of how we become alive in Christ Jesus. He says, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sin in which you used to live and followed the ways of the world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath." Not a great passage. This doesn't sound too good for us. Dead in our sin, yet we are still alive. Almost sounds like some horror movie. But it illustrates the condition of many people today. They're spiritually dead and they're unaware of their true condition. They don't know that sin is taking a hold of their lives and it's going to kill them. Did you know that when you're freezing to death, as the cold takes over, you begin to fight the cold with all you can. But eventually the cold takes over and you begin to feel warm. And then you stop fighting and you go unconscious. And because you feel warm all over and comfortable, you don't wake up. And then unfortunately at that point of time, the cold kills you. Well, that's exactly what sin does in our lives. Those who haven't given their lives to Jesus, those who are not followers of Christ, are dead in their sin. Sin's taken a hold. The passage tells us that at one time, all of us were dead in our sins. Maybe you say, "Well, I wasn't as dead as others. I was a pretty good person. I did good things. I wasn't accused of any terrible criminal offenses." Well, I want to tell you this morning, dead is dead. And you might not have been as dead as others, but you were dead in your trespasses and sin. We were subject to sin, subject to the world. We followed the ruler of the kingdom of the air, Satan, whether we realized it or not. But then we read in verse 4, "But," and that's the second thing I want to say this morning, "God is rich in mercy." Verse 4 says, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, And then verse 8 goes on and says again, "For it was by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so no one can boast." We were dead in our sins, but God. God is merciful and is gracious, rich in mercy. Mercy means we don't get what we deserve. What do we deserve? Punishment and death. But God is merciful. And grace means we get what we don't deserve. That's salvation in Jesus Christ. Someone once said that the greatest words in the Bible are, "But God." We were dead in our sin, but God. Many years ago, a comparative religion conference was taking place, and there were many wise theologians, scholarly men, who were in a lively debate about what is unique to Christianity. Some suggested the concept of the incarnation was unique, the idea that God took on human form. And others quickly said, well, in some other religions, these faiths also believe their gods appear in human form. And then another suggested the resurrection is what is unique about Christianity. The tomb was found empty. Another shook his head and said, well, in other religions, they also have accounts of people returning from the dead. C.S. Lewis was about to address these scholars in a presentation, and he walked into the room and this debate was continuing. He heard the lively conversation and finally he asked, what is all this commotion about? We're debating what's unique about Christianity. He looked at them and said, oh, that's easy. It's grace. Christianity uniquely claims God's love comes free of charge. No other religion makes that claim. And after some time looking at all the other religions, they agreed. It's grace that is unique in Christianity. Christianity proclaims God's love is unconditional. And that's what we call grace. Amazing grace. Grace has got absolutely nothing to do with us or our resolve. Grace is all about God and God freely giving his gifts to us, the gift of forgiveness, the gift of mercy, love, and the gift of salvation. His grace and mercy lead us to life in Jesus Christ. Amazing grace. This grace is so amazing, it doesn't matter what a wretched sinner you were, he saved us by his grace. And the scripture tells us, the third thing it tells us is, we've been made alive in Jesus Christ. I want to go back to verse 4 and read verse 4. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in his mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It's by grace you have been saved. And God's raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms with Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show his incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us by Christ, through Christ Jesus. We are alive because of Christ Jesus. He is the one who gives us his life abundantly and freely. This is all because of his incredible love for us. Jesus left his home in heaven for one purpose alone, to seek and to save those who were lost. Why did he do that? Well, we're told so clearly in John 3:16, because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. We are made alive in Christ because of God's incredible love for us. Christ gave up his life for us. He died for our salvation. Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 8, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing. Taking on the very nature of a servant, being found in human likeness, and being found in the appearance as man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Christ has made us alive. He laid down his own life. We are alive in him. This passage challenges us that we should have the same attitude of Christ. We should be willing to lay down our lives for him. I read the beautiful story of William Whiting Borden. He was a Christian missionary to Egypt with Samuel Zwemer. He was also the heir to the Borden family fortune. William graduated from Yale University and of Princeton Theological College in 1909. But during that time, Borden had been converted through the ministry of D.L. Moody, and he decided to become a Christian missionary to the Muslims in China. But before he could do that, he died of spinal meningitis while he was in Egypt doing his training for the mission field. He was only 25 years of age. After his death, Borden's Bible was found and it was given to his parents. And as they paged through his Bible, he had placed in one portion of the Bible, "No reserve," and the date, placing the note shortly before he renounced his family fortune in order to go and serve God and serve in missions. At a later point, he had written, "No retreat." That was dated shortly after his father told him that he would never ever be allowed to work in the family company again. And then shortly before he died in Egypt, he added the phrase, "No regrets." No reserve, no retreat, no regrets in following Jesus to do missions work. He was alive in Christ and is willing to lay down his life for Christ Jesus. We are alive in Jesus Christ. It's our honor to be able to lay down our lives in service of him. John 10:10, a scripture I love, says, "The thief has come only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life, and they have it to the full." Satan wants to come and kill and destroy. And that's what he's doing in the world. People are dead in their sin. But Jesus has come that we might have life, and he gives us the ultimate promise of not only life here, but life after death. There was a great preacher named Hinson, and just before he died, he shared this. He said, "I remember a year ago when the doctor told me, 'You have an illness from which you will not recover.' He said, I walked out to where I live, about 5 miles from Portland, Oregon, and I looked across at the mountains that I love. I looked at the river in which I've always rejoiced. And I looked at the stately trees that are always God's own poetry to my soul. Then in the evening, I looked up to the great sky where God was lighting his lamps. And I said, 'I may not see you many more times, but mountain, I shall be alive when you're gone. And river, I shall be alive when you cease running towards the sea. And stars, I will be alive when you have fallen from the sockets in the great pulling down of the material universe. I'm alive in Christ.' We are alive in Christ Jesus, and we will live forever, all because of Jesus, because of his mercy and his grace. We were dead in sin, but God, and we have been made alive in Christ. What amazing grace. The Lord bless you."
It's called greatly blessed, highly favored, and imperfect, but forgiven.
Greatly blessed.
Oh, you're going to sing it already. That'd be good.
Highly favored.
Imperfect.
And imperfect, but forgiven, child of God. Greatly blessed. Highly but forgiven, child of God.
Hey, the death is a good new year.
Greatly blessed.
Yes.
Highly favored.
Imperfect.
Imperfect, but forgiven, child of God. Greatly blessed. But forgiven, child of God, standing upright,
oh, yeah,
God's good earth, I'm counting my blessings, great things He has done. Fighting the good fight with the blessed assurance.
Imperfect,
but forgiven, child of God.
Greatly blessed.
Greatly blessed.
And highly favored.
Highly favored. Imperfect, but forgiven, child of God.
Sing it again.
Greatly blessed.
Let me hear you. Highly favored.
Highly favored.